What I feel about it was, I think it was, of course, totally wrong, but again, I'm going to be biased, okay? In the late 70s, we had 34 states pass laws, medical rights laws. Did it do any good? Nope. You know, now we have the Supreme Court saying this. So we've had so many opportunities for some change, and it hasn't happened yet. In some ways, it's going backwards.
Illness has no ideology. I mean, conservatives get cancer, liberals get cancer. Disease is ubiquitous. But treatment does have ideologies. The ideology of Western treatment is synthesis. Nothing from nature can be trusted unless it's passed through the hands of a scientist who's artificially manipulated it and then sold the product to someone who's going to own it and manufacture it. That's an ideology. And it's very deeply ingrained. A product like marijuana is offensive in almost every way to that concept of industrial medicine. It's naturally occurring, it's inexpensive, and even though the relief it provides is better, faster, safer, it simply doesn't fit the industrial format that FDA is designed to protect.
Most practitioners face-to-face will say, why would I ever want a patient to smoke a drug? Of the 488 substances that have been identified, most of those are not substances that I would want floating around in my system. Fungus, bacteria, etc.
That's mold.
When a physician writes a prescription, he's doing, in effect, a kind of risk-benefit analysis. Now, he's helped in making this calculation by the fact that this drug has been approved by the FDA and so forth and so on. But ultimately, it is a risk-benefit analysis.
Jeffrey was suffering from a post-traumatic stress disorder. He had witnessed his wife die in front of him. He had severe bipolar attributes to his illness, very, very depressed. Emotionally labile and volatile, and he had been unsuccessfully treated with a lot of antidepressant medications, mood stabilizers, antipsychotic medications. And then one day he came in and reported, well, you know, when I smoke some grass, I'm not like this.
At that point, Dr. Hochman said, well, since you were doing so good on marijuana, maybe we can get you on Marinol.
Marinol is a synthetic substance that is pure delta-9 THC. It was clear, and is clear, that some cannabinoids have medical uses. And when it was identified that delta-9 THC would be potentially useful, it was turned into a medically available substance that can be prescribed by practitioners.
The problem with it was that once it starts being absorbed, you can't stop it. Some people get no effect. Some people, it just knocks them out. They get anxious. They get upset. But with the inhaled, although it's got some impurities in it, certainly, the person can titrate the dose. He takes a puff. He stops. Nausea comes back. He takes another puff.
Presently, I'm at a substance abuse felony punishment facility for growing my own medical marijuana. Even my psychiatrist was saying at one point, if it was legal, what he felt would have been that I should be on Marinol and still having the ability to smoke. Kind of like doing an asthma pill, but still having the inhaler around.
You're drawing the heat across your... A lot of us entrepreneurs have come up with different ways to use the cannabis that will help save the lungs, which is basically heating the herb without burning it. You draw in like this, and you, very nice way of delivering the medicine healthfully.
Let the industry study their molecules, let them extract, let them do this sort of thing. I think that's great, and I think all the power to them. There will be patients who don't want to smoke joints to relieve their pain. They'll prefer to have something the doctor gives them.
To be able to produce a modern-day prescription medicine out of cannabis, one has to start with a material which is an illegal material in almost all countries in the world. We have air-conditioned, computer-controlled glass houses where we can control every aspect of the environment in which the plants grow. Through breeding programs, there's no genetic modification here. We're able to produce extremely precise, well-defined extracts from plants that have been under our control throughout their entire existence. We've formulated an oromucosal spray. That means we spray about 100 microliters onto the red, wet, shiny surfaces of the mouth. And the active ingredients will be absorbed directly from those surfaces, and some will also be swallowed. We have not attempted to single out particular molecules. We have really tried to reproduce in the spray the exposure to the same groups of molecules that one would find in normal natural cannabis.
We can take that pharmaceutical template, if you like, and apply it to the study of a herbal remedy like cannabis or St. John's wort or anything else. As long as we've got good quality, as long as we can show that it's safe, we can start looking at whether it works or not. I think that kind of program, that kind of research, that kind of attention to detail is something that we can actually learn from. And I see no reason why we shouldn't be applying that kind of principle to herbal cannabis.
Just over the years, we did more and more breeding with the marijuana until we created something like 30 to 32 distinct strains. And now we use primarily four of those 32 strains. Each year when I do the garden, I'll kind of just do a random membership survey. I go, okay, how many people like the sativa? How many people want the indica?
This is how we determine what to grow. It's what the patients tell us, what to use. One, how did you feel? Two, before my appetite was at a two, afterwards my appetite was at a 10.
Some of this darker red stuff seems to work a little bit better on the pain.
And over the course of using these surveys, it looks like, anyway, that cannabis indica works better for pain than cannabis sativa. Cannabis sativa seems to work better for nausea suppression and appetite stimulation. Some people say the cannabis indica works better for sleep, whereas the sativa, it makes them more awake and really makes their minds work. So it's based on the symptoms that it helps.
Anecdotal evidence does not hold the place it once did in medicine. I mean, all of medicine advanced until the mid-60s when the large double-blind controlled study was invented. And people who diminish the importance of anecdotal evidence behave as though medicine didn't know anything until the large double-blind study, and we didn't know anything about drugs until that happened. But the anecdotal evidence is there.
MS is very hard to deal with. Sometimes my legs will become so spastic, they will jump all over the place. They give you Valium for that, and the Valium, it helps slow it down a little, but does not alleviate it. And then there's that hungover, drugged feeling afterwards. I've discovered a few tokes, and the spasticity just calms right down.
My name is Yvonne, and I am not a criminal.
Yvonne Westbrook is one of our most outspoken members. She has followed this issue since she first found that it was beneficial for her condition to use medical cannabis, and got politically active, I think, because she saw the need of other patients to have support and access to this medicine safely. And I think she's been a good bit of support for our patients that aren't able to get out of their home.
I realized I didn't know how to act as a sick person. I wasn't the type to sit around feeling sorry for myself, so I had to get out and do something. I've been dealt lemons, make some lemonade.
I'm a stockbroker. I handle people's money. Using 12 cannabis cigarettes per day does not affect my job.
Hey, Jim, it's Urban returning your phone call. Sorry.
I'm totally clear-headed, and sometimes I wish I wasn't totally clear-headed.